invitation. I hope the voice will last for half an hour. It's most likely not be the case, and we will stop the music. The idea is to change a little bit gears of what we've been seeing the last yesterday and today, which is involved in the presentation, and to give you some flavor about nonlinear dynamics. The main argument is the following, is that there are very few concepts that are considered to be independent, which is molecular dissociations, that has been presented yesterday, that appeared artificial bumps, you can also discuss Van der Waals interactions if you wish. Electron main body tunneling, radio oscillations, which is a typical process if you want to do quantum information theory, or control photochemistry. And then something which has not been discussed but plays an important role is you want to know what is the population of a given state. And then if you, all those questions you ask yourself how to do it, you will face that you need the many body wave function. No, you answer the question, but you know the many body wave function. And the question is how we get the answer without writing the problem. Okay. Then I will address that all those points they have something in common, which is the non-locality in time of the change correlation kernel. Then it's to identify the problem, but not to give you the solution. It will be a partial solution to it. And then I will show you some examples on different systems. Okay, something that you're familiar is why it is non-linear dynamics. And this is the reason of real-time dynamics. Before getting to that, we heard during the last talks that there are two approaches to do linear response theory. There is real-time dynamics, the other is this Cassidy equation. There is another one which is an Einstein-Heimer approach, or what they call 2m plus 1 theorem, that is used in a few forms. And all of them are equivalent. The only difference is which is the cost of each of the methods. The most discussed here is the one in which you do some of the states. This is the standard way, but this is the most costly computation. And you have to keep something in mind. Every time you do linear response theory, you don't need empty states. This is by construction. You can do it everything with occupied states. Whether you want to do it or not, something like that, you can do it. However, and then in that regime, real-time dynamics, Einstein-Heimer, or some other states will give you the same answer. They should. However, try to do it, and you will see that most courts will not. Okay, and this is addressing the question this morning. Is if you take a Cassidy equation, but the trick is that you put very few number of empty states to compute the excitations. You put twice the number of the states that you need in order to address a given energy range. And you think this is converged. It's money. But then you say, okay, let's do the brute force approach. Solve completely the Cassidy equations, I diagonalize it, I can do it for very few systems, and I compare with my calculation with very few states. And you will realize that that one was not convergence. The convergence with the number of states is really, really small. It was also illustrated before, but when you start on the GW, it's the same problem with GW, and you need to do extrapolation. Or with the application based. There are some issues. And this, the only way to do it is by exact diagonalization of the fluid. And then you don't want to do it because it's a four-point function and it's too costly. And then for the same price, if you do time propagation, you will get full spectra without any error at the level of your spacing, which is also equivalent to the number of daisy sets that you have, and will be consistent. Okay. Then this is the beauty of an approach based on not using empty states. And then something that you didn't discuss but is important that you keep in mind, this is not in the talk, if you want to do magnetic responses and you use basis sets, as has been discussed all over the place, better you take care. Okay? Because then what happens is there is no way to do proper magnetic response with basis sets, so if you don't have gates in bio basis sets and you don't include the full set of empty states. That's the reason the chemist has been published, followed the literature, hundreds of papers on how to do MCD or magnetic responses in molecules. And they probably use some of the states. However, with this technique, it takes you only one line of code to change it and you get the magnetic response at the same cost as the optical response. And you can do magneto-optic, you can do everything. Right? I'm not saying you need to do it, but it's the easy way to do it. And the linear response, you don't care. And now comes the point, if you want to do non-linear response. A linear response, if you think the equations that were discussed this morning, you have to go to five-point functions, six, eight-point functions. Expansion with the orbitals increases. Instead of having four orbitals, you have six, eight. Then the sum gets explodes. You will do second harmonic generation. Third harmonic generation is basically computational, very easy. However, if you take the real-time dynamics, the only thing you need to change is the intensity of the field that you apply. And then you will accommodate first order, second order, third order response. This is the good thing. The bad thing is that you do not know how many orders do you include. Because you have to tune the parameter. Then the best way to do it is that you go slowly by increasing intensity, and when you are in the linear regime, you see that the energy changes linearly with the strength of the field and goes to parabolic regime. It was a cubic for it's not easy. But in many cases, you can do it. But at the end of the day, you don't care. Because in practical experiments, what you come is with very high intensity lasers. You are going to do time resolved spectroscopy. The only thing you need to put is the real intensity of the field. And that's it, which is beyond linear response. The best approach is to do real time dynamics. Then you will address problems like higher mode generation, if you want to get to create your synchrotron source in your laboratory, multiple ionization, photodissociation, enhanced ionization, electron quantum control, and all this is linked to photovoltaics, to many materials processing properties. Okay, let me, I know that I'm taking too long because this I didn't think to do it, but why I'm considering all those processes not linear response? Because you hear everybody talking about, let's get the ionization process as a linear response. They're going to get it from the linear response. Okay, just think of the following. Linear response, what means? Is that you change small amount of the density of a given system. What means a small is infinitesimally small. If you take a molecule and you add or remove one electron, whatever is the number of electrons that you have in the molecule, this is not a small perturbation. And there is no, if you really add one electron, then all the process in which electrons are added or removed, or electrons are moved from one orbital to another, they cannot be described in linear response theory. You can get in linear response theory how much is the energy cost for that process, but not how the electron goes or what is the reaction, not the activity on the way. Okay. And this is important because it's a misconception that you have many times when you try to describe just answer excitations, that they do not work in DFT. They don't. But they should, of course. Because in experiments, the way you get it is through this one electron process, which is beyond linear response. Okay, then now comes the question that I want to address and I want to illustrate. Then we will go a little bit fast in some of the slides, is how TDDFT, the way we know it works for different approximations, and then I will take you to some cases in which I illustrate how is the exact potential. And then you will see why we have so many problems in getting Van der Waals, getting dissociation, and getting that. But the DFT you all know, but let me remind you a little bit what is the two pieces of information in TDDFT that we need to get. Don't forget that all the discussion that we have in the past and has been done also for the DW, address the correlation part of the potential, which is you do MP2, MP4, or the quantum chemistry, and they are addressing how much is the electron-electron interaction modifying the correlation part. But there is one term of the potential of the DFT that is the vector field, which means every time you apply an electric field, you have an optical active material, the electron might not move in the direction of the field. You can have higher patterns. This is the light reference in many materials. If you have that, you induce this current, and this current in the system generates an artificial magnetic field. And then you have to include it. You do it in real calculation, but then implies that you have to have the corresponding exchange correlation response for the gamma, and this appears as a vector. But all calculations that you do is zero. But we have to keep in mind that this is a piece of information that might be relevant. And if you go to the homogeneous electron gas, other people they realize that this gives you many of the new phases, spiral phases that we have in the homogeneous electron gas. You can get it with these other systems. What you were seeing here is just one case of a simple reaction, which is the laser-induced oxidation. You have CO2, CH2, then you have with oxygen, and then you, with the laser, induce a triplet excitation in the oxygen, and at the end you come up with CO. Just to prove that you can do these chemical reactions on the fly. This one, quite fast. Okay. With the code, with the octopus, doesn't matter. Forget with octopus, because you can do it with GPO or with other codes. Where it is implemented, it doesn't matter. We do it in octopus by try this. Because most of those things we have it there. And let me tell you what is the state of the art. The optical magnetic responses are already available and you can access them by TDDFT. The quality of those will be depending on the quality of the function. And we are left to something which is a common quality of DFT. But it's important that it's linear and non-linear, and it's at the same cost. Then you can do both solids and structures and biomolecules. Eventually you can put biomolecules in solution, we cannot, we don't have it yet in the code, but with Christian we have things like those now. And then the question is about correlations, that you can describe what insulators, I will not show it to you, but if you're interested we can discuss it later with DFT. And then the question that comes for people, which is not for the developers, but for more fundamental, is how to develop more accurate functions. And there are different strategies based on many body perturbation theory, by strategies as the one that Peter was showing yesterday on photon deposits. Okay, then let me take you to a few things and then hopefully you tell me which one, time goes fast, which one might be interesting. Probably we go to photoelectron spectroscopy and we will see the photoelectron. Let's take one case, which is beyond linear response, that I hope you understand, and then you will see the link of density functional series with many-body approaches. Was discussed also yesterday that in many-body you have access to the n-1 and n+1 states through the Green's function, and that's the beauty of GW, because we get these excitations automatically from many-body perturbation. And this is a common wisdom that tells you that density functional schemes will not be able to describe photoelectron spectroscopy because it's an N electron excitation, it's a neutral excitation. Okay, this is common wisdom, as always, because there is no proof that this is the case. Okay, let me tell you a few things. Why people think that Green's functions give you photoelectron spectra has an approximation behind, which is the three-step models of photoemission. And it's not a mathematical proof that you can come to the idea that Green's functions give you photoelectron spectra. Then, and this, in this model, what you assume is that you have a many-body wave function, which is n-1 product of the wave. If you take that scheme, you can also do it in DFT. But the only thing you need to do is you define a simulation region and a detector, a detecting region, in which you are going to collect electrons, that they come in, and then count how many electrons they are. And then you remove them from the simulation. Which is basically what you do in your experimental device. If the box is big enough, you will converge. Then there is no reason that you cannot get photoelectron spectroscopy. The question is whether it's practical. And this is something we will discuss today. Okay, you might think this is an idea which works, and indeed it does, but it took many years to get it work. And the main reason is because if you do this naive approach, it will never work. There is a lot of standing waves that set up in the system, and then at the end of the day, you get a rumor, which is noise of the calculation. And do whatever you want, it's basically numerically impossible to get it stable. Then the trick now came that you, instead of having two regions, you have three regions. You put one, which is the pool in the anti-mechanical part. This is a region that you define as free electron propagation. That is in which electrons, that they reach that region, they can decide through the Hamiltonian whether they are going to leave or to come back to the system. And then you have the accumulating region outside, which is for free electrons. And in this way, you have a three-step process, and then you can get electrons with the laser frequency that go, stays a little bit here and come back, or stays a little bit here and go back. This interference process becomes important, and then to describe what I will show you later. And it's not much difficult to do. track of you. It's only a non-locality. Then let me show you how does it work, and you will see. This is the case of the hydrogen atom. Forget about the equations, you have it in the PDF. But this is how you will do the simulation if you want to implement it. And this is one electron system that you can do it analytically. Okay? You put a 2 femtosecond laser pulse, very intense, and then you see that the electron of hydrogen is emitted in two rays. Each one of these rays corresponds to third harmonic fifth cell. It's all the harmonics. And then you can see in the especially how they go out. The question is, and this is an analytical result, can I describe the same physics with a box? And then what you do is you take a small box, which is only 60 units. Small for these things is really small. For many things in 3D it's not so small, but you cannot do it small. Then you can see that the simulating spectrum with this technique in which the electron can go and come back is quite similar, if it's not equal to the exact. Then the numerical implementation of these three regions is good and give you a good approach to photoelectric systems. Then you can now go to real systems, and then this makes the proof of concept. You have a nitrogen 2 molecule, you can be the laser field, and this is experimental data. Let me tell you, this is LDA. LDA for many things works extremely well. Surprisingly, but it works. And then there are a few things that you need to know. When you come with the laser field, the electrons could be emitted to the right or to the left. And there is an asymmetry in whether it's right or left, depending on the shape of the laser pass, because it's not completely symmetric in time. There is an asymmetry in the preference of the electrons to be emitted in one direction or the other that you see in the spectrum. If you take what the people in the field is doing, strong field approximation, which is just one electron which is active, basically this is what they got, and they were extremely happy for many years with this approximation. This is what everybody is using, this field electron lasers, this strong field approximation. But just with this approach of the full mask, you can reproduce more or less quite good the experimental data and the same. If you look into detail, there are some discrepancies in the densities and the width of the peaks, but you wouldn't expect LDA to give you exact data of the time result. Okay. Then with that, we go to the next step, which, as we have something that allows us to monitor electrons and to monitor photons, we can do two things, which is transient photoelectron spectroscopy and transient photoabsorption spectroscopy. Those are, if you think of the language of response fashion, those are third and fourth order response fashion. That's if you can do pump probe, and then you can monitor in time the response to an electric field with a magnetic field, the higher order response fashion. And then there is something which is just for sharing, because the physics is not, but you can reconstruct and monitor the functions and processes of a given system. Tomography, quantum tomography is called, but there is not much more physics there besides that we can do. Okay. Let me take you one case and then you can see how what you do in experiments you can do it in the computer. And then let's take one simple molecule, which is C2H4, which is ethylene. The main reason why we took this one is because there is a beautiful pi-star transition that you can excite if the laser polarizes in this direction. And what we did is we came with a laser in this direction, we excite the pi-pi transition, and then as a function of time, we monitor the photoabsorption cross-section, which is basically the reality of absorbing light. And once, what you can see is at the beginning, there is no peak coming from excited states from the LUMO to the higher order excited states. Then as long as you are populating the LUMO, you will start that this peak starts to show, which is how much the LUMO is being populated. This is what is used in two-dimensional spectroscopy to see in biological molecules how porphyrins interact in the chlorophyll. Because then you can see if this porphyrin is interacting with this, how the spectrum of this one is modified by the predator. And then you can see it in time. This is monitoring how the excitations occur. This way is optics. And it's very simple. You don't get any information about the shape of the orbitals. If you want to get shape of the orbitals, you have to change. And then now you do pump probe, really pump probe, which means you excite with a very long laser, which is high intense, which is the pump. Why is intense? Because you really want to populate the LUMO. And then with the probe, will be a very high frequency photon at very low intensity. The main reason is because this will not modify strongly the response of your system. The only thing it will do is it will take the electron in the state that it is and bring it to the continuum, and then you detect it. And you want that this laser has little influence to the system, but you want the intensity to be low. And then basically this is to give you the scale. This is 1.8 atomic units, which is huge for these systems. And the pump frequency is tuned to the pipeline standards. Then what you see in this photoelectron spectroscopy, you can do also negative delays, which is the probe comes before the pump, which means with the probe you are monitoring the occupied states of your system. Which is the HOMO, and the NUMO, and the NUMO-plasma. And then when the delay is the right one, with first the pump, then you start seeing how this peak appears, which becomes more red, and then you start getting something which is extremely interesting, with non-linear processes. Because the pump is so intense that you can absorb one photon, two, three. Then you will get one photon, two, three, if you want to dream. Four, five, six. In principle, you get more, but you see clearly one, two, and three processes. Which is good, because this tells you that you are really populating the LUMO. You have information about the LUMO. And now the question is, can I extract information about this LUMO? And then let me show you what we can now do, and this is the movie, is the kinetic energy of how electrons go. It's a 3D draw. Okay. We will see it twice. First, let me tell you how would it look like if you did have the pi star. The pi star is characterized by this symmetry. In the photoelectron spectra, we will have a maximum intensity on a shell that is outside with higher intensity here. This is rotated for you to see. Okay? It's completely symmetric here and in the bottom. And I'm not breaking any symmetry of the pi orbit. You don't see this now because it's not very difficult to see the field. And the pi star, just to see the nodal structure, you get the same structure that shifted. This is the standard nodal structure of a pi star. Then those two are the ones that you have to see in the movie of the photoelectron spectra. And indeed is what happened. At the beginning you have the pi orbital, which is here. And as long as your time is evolving, you start to see that this will speed. Then you will get some more intensity here. But something which I wanted you to see that look more like a I let you decide what it looks like, but the inner part of the spectra, which is the multiphoton processes. You can see how fast one photon, two photon, three photon processes appear, and what is the symmetry of those orbitals, which is going to pi, to d, wave, a high order orbital. And all the information about the nonlinear phenomena and multiphoton processes is inside this sphere of k-momentum resolved photoelectron spectra. And the outer part gives you the information about the pi-pi star. Then you can do the monitor. That's what the people with the field electro lasers do. They tell you, we have seen the power of the human body. Then in fact, you could, but you have to have the information. The beauty here is that this we did it on purpose, because there are other molecules. If you want to do the same to other molecules, you don't see it. There's no way to identify the other. Then also, and as we cannot do it in the calculation, they cannot do it in the spec. They measure those electrons, they don't have all the information. Okay, then in summary, with this technique in which you have all the angles, you can see how you go from a pi to a pi star transition, and then you can monitor this process in time. Which is the then just saying, this will be brief, just to tell you something that we are discussing those techniques of hydrogen and electric field. How many minutes?
3-4.
Okay, then this will be fast. This, just to tell you that if you have an electric field in the length gauge is non-periodic. Then this brings one point. It's how you are going to treat magnetic fields for periodic systems. The answer to that is OK. We don't know how to do it. But we means no one. Then if you want to do really magnetic response of solids, real, time-dependent magnetic response of solids, you cannot. You have to do approximating calculations in the length of gauge. And that's what the people is publishing all the time. But full first principles from time. Then the now the just to tell you something about implementation, the only thing you have to do is to change gates. It's a nice way of understanding the problem. Is you don't have a length gauge, if you make it in the velocity gauge, just the Maxwell equation, and a static electric field becomes a time-dependent vector field. By the time the vector field is homogeneous. This is just Maxwell equation. We didn't do anything. Then you just work in these gates, in which you have the standard field, which is your macroscopic field, including periodic, but time-dependent. And this is what brings you to the concept that if you have a time-dependent phenomenon approach, you will be able to describe the response of solids at a given level of approximation. And what you do is you plug this with Maxwell equations, which is the vector field will be the standard plus the induced one. You plug it into the Maxwell, and then you can get the polarization through the evolution of the vector field. What is the advantage? That you can increase the intensity of the field at will. You can do second order, knowledge generation, third, fourth, anything, as long as the magnetic fields. And this is something new, because this is something you cannot do otherwise. Then, this for, I don't know if there are fundamentalist people here, but there is something which, if you take this one, you have it in the notes, and then you plug this macroscopic current. I am not doing anything but plugging the solutions of the previous equation in the macroscopic current. You plug the periodic part, and you get this relation. And then you believe me, if you plug the equations that nothing else, you get that the variation of the polarization with respect to time is this equation, which is the variation of the periodic part of the wave function with respect to time, and the gradient of the wave function with respect to k. And this is exactly what you get in the very phase. The very phase, which is the expression from the very phase. Then this technique by time propagation describes everything which is considered the modern theory of polarization. Automatically. And then you don't need to do it. And it works equally then just to tell you that if you take linear response to what in and other people were showing today, and you do it in time propagation, you get the same spectrum. You should. If the intensities of this is for lithium, for carbon, for silicon carbide, for aluminum phosphate, of course you get the same products. If the LEA is not working, the time propagation will not solve the problem. You get the same error that you knew before. And then something which is completely new, you can do also magnetic response and spinorial response, which is non-linear magnetism. And then also the agreement for yields spectra of iron and other metal systems is quite good, surprisingly good to the level of the LEA. And this basically is what I wanted to show, that all these things could be implemented easily in other codes. And then what was more interesting is how to do this part of the exact independent kernel, that I will not show it to you. Just this one, which is the one that is interesting for the people working here, which is the charge transfer excellence. Then you believe me that we have a technique to giving a density to extract the exact potential. Then what I took, just a simple case, two well potential, two electrons on one well, zero electrons on the other one, and then I apply a laser field, and I end up in one electron here and one electron here, which is a charge transfer excellence. And then you can ask how good an adiabatic approximation will describe that. If you look to the potential, the first thing you realize is that the derivative discontinuity for exact an adiabatic functional is different. The adiabatic functional will not be able to give you the right derivative discontinuity. It will give you some, but not the right one. And this was discussed yesterday. But on top of it, what happened, and this is the tricky part, and this is the problem, is as soon as the electron goes out from the one well and appears in the other well, the change correlation potential develops peaks in the middle. And that time dependent. I will not show it. I have a movie. And then you can see that. And those we are not able to describe. For two electrons, three electrons, we have a potential that took the job away. But for more electrons, we have. And this is the open question that has to be explained in the movie, and all of the sounding together. I conclude, I just put the people that did the work. This is the higher one generation. And then this is the conclusion that I hope that you agree that with these techniques we can describe this non-linear phenomena, and the work could be done in these functionals. And then there are many people, as is also here, discussed, but that have been involved in the higher energy generation, in optimal control, in the photoelectron spectroscopy. I conclude with this project showing you Thank you for your attention.
I'm sure we have time for a question or two. Yeah?
You had AX. I'm curious about these functionals that you were using. So you were saying that you want a non-locality in time, so you're not using ALDA. Is that correct?
No.
You're not using ALDA?
No. Good. For the things that I showed you in the solids, I use ALDA because it was a proof that the technique gives what you should get.
No, that was a little confusion. So, but then you had AXC. So that word supports suggests that you have a time, you know, current time dependent current density functional theory. Is that correct?
It could be if you want, but you can loop because as long as there is no magnetic fields,
you can change
the density. Then what you know is everything in terms of the density.
Okay.
And it appears as an integral over time. Mm-hmm. Would be easier maybe in current density functions.
Last related question, was there a reference to the functionals that you were actually using?
In the first slide.
So in any slide, there will be a reference to the functional that you're actually using. Okay.
And last question.
Sorry. You did this nice quadrant spectroscopy calculations. I wonder for quadrant spectroscopy, the precision of the HOMO level is extremely important.
Yes.
Relative to the vacuum. So do you account for any exact exchange or satellite dimension?
But we did those calculations were not done with the LDA level, they were done with LD94, which is very similar with a one overlap.
Okay.
That gives you the value.
Yeah.